In this video, we're going to talk about the stages of labor. And more specifically, we're going to talk about how the baby passes through the pelvis, how the cervix effaces and dilates, and about the first, second, and third stage of labor. So this is our pelvis, and I'm going to name the parts of the pelvis, and you can feel some of them on your own body. So these are your hip bones right here, and you can feel those on your sides. Down here are your sits bones. You can feel those bones. You're sitting on them right now, most likely. Then we have the pubic bone in the front and the sacrum, or the tailbone, in the back. Now, most people don't realize this, but the pelvis can actually move and shift and be a little bit flexible, especially during pregnancy. During pregnancy, you're releasing a hormone called relaxin, and its effects sound just like the word. It relaxes the joints in your body, and that helps make it easier for the baby to pass the pelvis. So the pelvis is a little bit flexible. One of the parts that is flexible is the tailbone. See here, this, or we call it the sacrum. The sacrum can change positions depending on how you're positioned. So if you're lying on your back, your tailbone moves up a little bit, and it makes this space, which we call the pelvic outlet, it makes that space smaller and less room for the baby to come out. So when you're in upright positions, there's more room here at the outlet or the bottom of the pelvis. So this is our baby, and the baby's head is actually flexible as well. If you see these little spots here, these are called fontanelles, or the soft spots. And if you've ever felt a newborn baby's head, you can feel those soft spots on their skull. Those exist so that your baby's head can change shape or mold as it's coming through the pelvis. If you've ever seen a picture of a newborn baby with a cone-shaped head, that's because their head molded to fit or flex through the pelvis. And then the skull returns to its normal shape several days after the birth. So we have two flexible parts during the birth, the pelvis and the baby's head. Now, when someone is pregnant with a baby, the baby's gonna be tucked up inside the uterus, and this is my plush uterus from I Heart Guts. It says, uterus, get a womb. And obviously, I also have a little bit more realistic in terms of size uterus for when you're pregnant at the end of pregnancy with the baby tucked up inside. The other organ that's important to understand with the stages of labor is the placenta. And so I have a plushy placenta, and it says, placenta, baby's first roommate. The placenta is the body's only temporary organ. The placenta supplies all the oxygen and nourishment during pregnancy that your baby needs. It also releases a lot of hormones to protect the pregnancy and continue the pregnancy. And so with my uterus here, the top of the uterus here is the fundus. This is what they're measuring when you're at a prenatal appointment and they're feeling for the fundal height. They're measuring the fundus of the top of the uterus. And this bottom part, this is the cervix. This is the neck of the uterus. And inside we have our baby. But between your baby and the uterus, there's actually another part, and that is the amniotic sac. So you have this amniotic membrane that is serving as a protective barrier to the outside world. It also contains the amniotic fluid, or your bag of waters. So when someone says your water broke, what they mean is that there was a little tear or rip in that amniotic membrane, and the fluid might leak out or it might gush out depending on how big the tear is. That fluid is in there for a purpose. It helps your baby kind of move around. They're kind of swimming around inside of you. And also it cushions them. For example, if you happen to fall or be in an accident, that fluid that the baby's floating around in is protecting them as well. So if we take the baby out of the uterus and just looked at the amniotic membrane, you can see how the baby is tucked up inside of there. They're attached to their umbilical cord, and the umbilical cord is attached to the placenta. This placenta then is adhered or attached to the wall of the uterus. So after the baby is born, the placenta is going to have to be born as well. Now, earlier when I was talking about the uterus and the fundus and the cervix here is going to serve as the sort of passageway out into the world for the baby. So I want to talk a little bit about the changes that the cervix will have to undergo. This bottle, if we hold it upside down, could be like the neck of a cervix. Whoa, it's leaking. So make it a little bit tighter so I don't get vinegar all over me. So this vinegar bottle that just leaked all over me has a long, narrow neck. And this kind of is like the cervix before labor begins. It's a long, narrow neck. What we need the cervix to do is to turn more into like this peanut butter jar where there is a wide opening, but also a very thin neck so that the neck is almost just continuous with the rest of the bottle. Now, before the cervix can open, it has to start thinning first. And the medical term for that is effacement. So we say that the cervix effaces. So your cervix has to get soft and thin or efface, and then eventually it'll start opening. We call this process of the cervix thinning and effacing, we call that cervical ripening. So in medical terminology, they might talk about this in terms of percentages. So if they say you're 0% effaced, then you're gonna be more like a long, narrow neck there. If they say you are 100% effaced, that means that the cervix will become thin here, and then that's called 100% effaced. Now, another thing you hear a lot of people talk about in terms of labor and birth is cervical dilation. So this gives us a visual of how the cervix dilate. We've already talked about effacement, so now we're talking about dilation, which is basically the opening of the cervix. There is a little plug at the bottom of your cervix. I forgot to mention that. But there is a little plug of mucus that is going to help stopper up the bottom of that uterus. And at some point towards the end of pregnancy or at the start of labor, that plug will fall out. It's just like a little plug of mucus, looks like boogers, you might call it, and that falls out. Another thing that you might see when you start dilating or opening is something called bloody show. Bloody show is a small amount of blood you might find in your underwear or on a pad, and in some cases, that's a sign that labor is starting. So as you can see, dilation happens progressively. So this is 1 centimeter dilated, and I can just barely, not even really get my fingertip in there. And then you can see we have 2 centimeters, and then with 3 centimeters, I can get 2 full fingers in there, and we can go to 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and with a 10. And obviously, most people know that the goal is to get to a 10, and once the provider can no longer feel the cervix, it means that you've reached 10 centimeters dilated. The only way to check for dilation is through an internal exam, either a self-exam or an exam provided by a care provider. Some people prefer to this type of exam as a vaginal exam, a pelvic exam, or cervical exam. I mentioned before that there are 2 flexible parts, the baby's head and the pelvis. The baby plays a really important role in the progression of labor in this process. In the case of dilation, as the baby is descending into the pelvis, going deeper into the pelvis, their head will hopefully be resting on that cervix and putting pressure on the cervix. And the pressure from the baby's head actually assists with effacement and dilation. Now let's talk about contractions of the uterus. For a lot of people, it's normal to have contractions in late pregnancy called Braxton Hicks contractions. You might notice these starting at around 20 weeks. These contractions do not dilate the cervix, but they might feel like a tightening of the uterus. I like to call them practice contractions. And usually they do not cause pain, although sometimes they can be intense. When labor begins, the person who's giving birth will experience regular contractions that get stronger, longer, and closer together. And those contractions cause progressive changes to the cervix. So the difference with Braxton Hicks contractions is that those do not change your cervix. Now the word contraction can have bad connotations. A lot of people automatically associate the word contraction with pain. So a lot of people choose to call contraction something different. This is a technique from something called cognitive behavior therapy, where you give something a different name or label it differently so that you start to think about it differently. Some people choose to call contractions waves or surges or pressure waves. In our evidence-based birth chamber class, we encourage parents to consider using a different term like wave instead of the word contraction. And we talk more about that more in depth in the evidence-based birth chamber class. So when the uterus starts contracting and the cervix is changing, this is when stage one of labor begins. Stage one begins with the onset of labor and it ends when you get to that 10 centimeters of dilation. How long does this last? Well, for someone who's giving birth for the first time, it's usual or common for it to last anywhere from 12 to 24 hours. However, it can take longer for some people, even 2 to 3 days. And that is more common with a medical labor induction when they give you medications to start your labor. Labor can be shorter for someone who's given birth before. Also, labor can be short for some people who experience something called a precipitous birth. A precipitous birth is when you give birth very, very quickly in less than 3 hours. And it's more common if you've had a baby before to have a precipitous birth. It's less likely in a first-time parent. However, it can occasionally happen to someone who's giving birth for the first time. In fact, it's happened to a few students who've taken our evidence-based birth childbirth class, and they've come on the EBB podcast to talk about their experiences. The first stage of labor can also be divided into additional phases. So we have early labor, active labor, and transition. Early labor is also sometimes called latent labor. And the purpose of contractions or waves during this phase is to gently push the baby down and pull up on the cervix to help open the cervix. So the contractions are helping push the baby down and ripen the cervix or efface and start to open the cervix. During early labor, people are able to cope pretty easily. You might be able to watch a TV show or talk on the phone or go on a walk or do things around your home or work on a project. During early labor, the contractions or waves last only about 30 to 40 seconds. And they happen anywhere from every 5 to every 30 minutes. Now, I want to give you a newsflash. In many movies or TV shows, they portray labor as one long, never-ending, extremely painful contraction. But in reality, you get a break in between each wave. Also, another important note for you to understand when we're talking about contractions is that when you time contractions, you time them from the beginning of one the beginning of the next one. So that's how they're timed. So in that early phase of the first stage of labor, your cervix is effacing or thinning and it's dilating. It's going from a 1 to a 2 to a 3 to a 4. And believe it or not, this is still considered very early labor. And you dilate to a 5 and a 6. And by the time you get to 6, this is considered the active phase of the first stage of labor. They used to think that active labor started around 4 centimeters, but now there's pretty much a consensus among researchers and medical groups that for most people, 6 centimeters is the start of what we call the active phase of labor. Once you get to the active phase, you're going to be experiencing a contraction or wave that lasts about 1 minute. So they last about 60 seconds long and they're occurring every 3 to 4 minutes. And with active labor, you're gonna move on to 7 and 8. And when you get to 8, this is what we call transition. Now, when we hit active labor, for some people, when they reach 6 centimeters, things start moving really quickly, especially if you've given birth vaginally before. But for most first-time parents, research shows that it tends to be a slow, steady progression from centimeter to centimeter. And in fact, in this early phase, it's normal for you to have kind of where it takes hours to get from 1 centimeter to the next. So it's very normal for this early phase to take a long time. For some people, it starts speeding up when you get to a 6. For other people, it tends to be a slow, steady progression. So once we've reached 8 and 9 centimeters, this is what we call transition. Transition is an important phase because it means you're getting really close to meeting your baby. And some people actually like to call it transformation because you're transforming from someone who had a baby on the inside to somebody who has a baby on the outside. During this transition phase here, when you're progressing all the way up to a 10, the contractions may last a minute and a half or 90 seconds, and they may be coming as frequently as every 2 minutes. So if you time the contractions correctly, that means that you have a 90 second contraction with 30 seconds of break, and then the contraction starts again. During transition, your body is flooding you with hormones to prepare you and your baby for the moment of birth. These hormones may make you feel nauseous, shaky, you might feel very hot or very cold, and you may have feelings of doubt, like, I can't do this anymore. You also might be feeling a lot of pressure in your bottom, and you may be needing a lot of support during this phase of labor. All of these signs are pointing to the fact that you're getting very close to the pushing phase. And although this phase of transition may feel very intense, thankfully for most people, it's the shortest phase of labor. By the time we get to 10 centimeters, I can even fit my hand through here. And once we get to a 10, we can say that we are done with stage 1, and we're going to be moving on to stage 2, the pushing phase.